Students, in the past few lectures we have learnt about capacitors and how to deal with energy heat produced and capacitors connected in series and as well as parallel, redistribution of charge on capacitors when connected with each other, and finding charge on each capacitor when you are connecting it to the battery, and also effective capacitance when plates are being connected. So these things we have discussed in past few lectures, and today we will be continuing our learning about capacitors, and we will use Wheatstone bridge to solve few problems today. And about Wheatstone bridge you will be learning in current electricity. In detail we will derive equation for bridge balancing condition for Wheatstone bridge. Those will be discussed in current electricity. In this session just I'll explain what is mean by Wheatstone bridge. See, we have five capacitors here: C1, C2, C3, C4, and this middle one, C5. They have different capacities. C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, all are of different capacities. Plates are being connected to the battery. Now here it is positive and this is negative. When charge flow, like when you are connecting these capacitors combination with battery, what would happen? Definitely charge will be drawn from these two plates. Like this is one plate, from one of the plate of C1 and one of the plate of C3, charge will be drawn and it will be passed to the other plates in order to maintain the potential difference equal to that of potential of the battery. This we have already learnt in past lectures. Now if at all the potential at this point A and potential at this point B, potential at this point A and potential at this point B, if I consider those two potentials are equal, right? If potential at A is equal to potential at B, that means potential at this position and this position, if it is equal, then what would happen? If C directly to AB, there is only one capacitor connected, that is a C5. And check it up, C1 is connected between V and A, C3 is connected between V and B, C4 is connected between B and 0, C2 is connected between A and 0. Only C5 is in between A and B, right? And potential at A is equal to potential at B, as there is no potential difference. Delta V is equal to 0, since potential at A is equal to potential at B, potential difference across that capacitor will be equal to 0. If potential difference across that capacitor is equal to 0, Q on C5 capacitor will be equal to C5 into delta V, where delta V is the potential difference of this capacitor C5. So I can write Q on C5 will be equal to C5 into delta V is 0, this is equal to 0. Therefore, even though the capacitor C5 is connected in between A and B, whose potentials are equal, there is no charge distributed upon this C5. Whole charge will be drawn only between C1, C3, C2, C4. So simply, we can eliminate this C5 as there is no charge distribution over C5. I can redraw the circuit in the simple form like this. this is C1, this is C2, and this is C3, and this is C4. And here this end is connected to positive of the battery, and this end is connected to negative of the battery. Now I am eliminating this C5 because the potential difference across C5 is zero. Therefore, charge distribution will be equal to zero. No charge flow into this capacitor C5. Therefore, even though you are connecting C5 in between A and B, it is useless because that capacitor plate's charge is not being used. So finally, you are left with these four capacitors. And when you are left with these four capacitors, you can clearly understand, like, for this, if this battery is drawing some charge Q from C1 and C3, then from here Q1 charge will be drawn, and from here Q2 charge will be drawn. Q1 charge as this two, C1 and C2, both are connected in series. Therefore, here you will be having same charge Q1. C2 and C3 and C4 both are connected in series. Here also you will have same charge Q2. And overall, Q can be written as Q1 plus Q2. Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2. Net charge transferred by the battery is equal to charge over this plate C1 and charge over this capacitor C3. So that is Q1 plus Q2. This is KCL. And you can use KVL for this closed loop. It is 1. You can use KVL for this closed loop even. Like from here, you can connect the battery and you can come over here. So you can use as many loops as possible. Like this is 1 and this is 2. Likewise, you can take 3 as this. You can take 3 even this closed loop as 3. This as 3. The one with black mark. So you can use KVL over there. You can use KVL over there. So whenever you are getting this kind of circuit, such that potential at A and potential at B is equal, then you can eliminate C5, and such type of bridge is called as Wheatstone bridge, and it is balanced Wheatstone bridge. Such type of circuit is called as, it is known as balanced Wheatstone bridge. And whenever such type of circuit is being observed, you can check the condition whether the bridge is balanced or not by taking the ratio of the capacitors. C1 divided by C3 is equal to C2 divided by C4. If this ratio is satisfied, the ratio of capacitor connected over C1 and C3, C1 by C3 is equal to C2 divided by C4. If this condition is satisfied, then potential at A is equal to potential at B. Suppose if this condition is not satisfied, potential at A and potential at B are not equal, then in such case, there will be some charge flowing through C5 also. Therefore, you cannot eliminate this C5. So whenever you are getting such type of Wheatstone bridge circuits, you need to check whether the bridge is balanced or not. You can, in order to check whether bridge is balanced or not, you need to use this condition: ratio of the capacitors, if they are equal, then bridge is balanced. If bridge is balanced, potential at A and potential at B will be equal. Therefore, you can eliminate C5. C1, C2 become series. C3, C4 become series. Overall become parallel, so that you can find out the effective capacitance of the circuit. Suppose if C5, like if this ratio is not balanced, C1 by C3 is not equal to C2 by C4. In such cases, bridge is not balanced. If bridge is not balanced, then you cannot eliminate C5. Such type of circuit is said to be unbalanced Wheatstone bridge. Okay, balanced Wheatstone bridge and unbalanced Wheatstone bridge. If the ratio is not satisfied, then it is unbalanced Wheatstone bridge. For unbalanced Wheatstone bridge, you cannot eliminate C5. There is other method. You can use Kirchhoff laws and you can find out the effective charge on each capacitor. That I'll explain to you in the later classes. For time being, you just remember only Wheatstone bridge balanced circuits. Students, you need to remember these conditions for balanced Wheatstone bridge and unbalanced Wheatstone bridge. And this is like, remember, for a Wheatstone bridge, definitely there will be 5 components, whether it may be capacitors or whether it may be resistors. Definitely there should be 5 components in that circuit, then only it can become Wheatstone bridge. The other forms, there are few other forms, like circuit may not be exactly seen in this way. There are 2 more forms of Wheatstone bridge. I'll draw it for you. So whenever you are getting such type of circuits, you can identify them and you can exactly check whether the balance bridge balanced or not. Wheatstone bridge, like always, the circuit may not be exactly like this. So this is one form of Wheatstone bridge. This is second form of Wheatstone bridge. It looks like a triangle. And this is third form of Wheatstone bridge. Any of these circuits, if bridge is balanced, then in such cases, you can eliminate one of the capacitors. That is the middle capacitor you can eliminate. So here we will be eliminating C5. Here we will be eliminating this capacitor. Here we will be eliminating this capacitor, right? In all the cases, like if bridge is balanced, then only you can eliminate that. If bridge is not balanced, then in such cases, you cannot eliminate that. You will be using Kirchhoff's laws and solve the problem. Let us solve one problem based on Wheatstone bridge. See, here we have different capacitors and all capacitors are having same capacity. It is a C. Everywhere capacity of capacitor is a C. Now, these all capacitors are connected between A and B. This is A and this is B. You are supposed to find out effective capacitance. You are supposed to find out effective capacitance of the whole circuits. In this case, when you are able to see the circuit, immediately you should tell that this is Wheatstone bridge, because see, in the upper part, this part, if you observe carefully, this become Wheatstone bridge. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, totally 5 capacitors are there, and ratio of these two, it is equal, because C by C is equal to C by C. This is equal to 1 and bridge is balanced. As bridge is balanced, you can eliminate this capacitor. If you eliminate this capacitor, the redrawn circuit can be like this. This is capacitor C and this is capacitor C, and here is point A and this is point B, and here you have capacitor C, here you have capacitor C, and finally that is connected to another capacitor C. Now this after removing this middle capacitor, you can exactly tell these two capacitors are connected in series. Its value is C, its value is C. What is the effective capacitance of this total? It will be C/2. And these are connected in series. What is the effective capacitance here? C/2. C/2, C/2, and this is C. All the three are connected in parallel between A and B. So therefore, as these are parallel, C equivalent will be equal to C/2 plus C/2 plus C. That is C plus C, which is equal to 2C. Equivalent capacitance is 2C. Like this. See, for your understanding, I am solving one more question. So you have different capacitors connected over here. This is point A and this is point B. You should find out the effective capacitance here. Now, whenever you are seeing this circuit, immediately you should identify that it is Wheatstone bridge. If you are unable to identify that it has Wheatstone bridge, then no one can help you. You cannot solve this problem by regular method. You cannot redraw this into simpler form. This is Wheatstone bridge, right? Now you should check whether this is balanced or not. So for that, what you will do? These two ratio and these two ratio, it should be equal. So how it is written as 5 micro divided by 10 micro, this is equal to 1/2. And what about the second one? 15 divided by 30, this is also equal to 1/2. 1/2, 1/2. Ratio of these capacitors are equal. Therefore, bridge is balanced. As bridge is balanced, what you will do? Simply you will eliminate this 10 microfarad capacitor. This gives you, if you eliminate that 10 microfarad capacitor, you will get finally left over with these capacitors. Check it up. these are the capacitors left over with. This is point A and this is point B. Here you have 5 microfarad, you have 15 microfarad, and this is 10 microfarad, and this is 30 microfarad. Okay, these two are connected in series. These two are connected in series. Effective is connected in parallel. 5 and 15, they are in series. 10 and 30, they are in series. So you can find out the effective capacitance between these. Okay, this is how bridge balanced condition you need to first cross check and you need to find out the circuit. Okay, sometimes it may not be the same way. Like sometimes bridge may not be balanced. Let me show you. For example, the same circuit, I am taking it like this. This is 5 microfarad, this is 10 microfarad, this is 10 microfarad, and this is 5 microfarad. And in middle you have one capacitor, this is 20 microfarad. This is the circuit given to you. You are now supposed to find out C effective. This is A and this is B. It is C effective. You need to find out C effective. And now you need to check. Of course, this is a Wheatstone bridge, but you need to check whether bridge is balanced or not. For that, what you'll do, you'll take ratio of these two. 5 by 10 is not equal to 10 divided by 5, right? Bridge is not balanced. Right? Bridge is not balanced. If bridge is not balanced, then individually you should use Kirchhoff laws and you need to find out the effective capacitance that you will be learning in the next coming videos. Or in current electricity, I will teach you how to solve problem based on Wheatstone bridge if bridge is not balanced. In current electricity chapter, I will teach you. Now see, in this case, bridge is not balanced. You cannot eliminate this 20 microfarad. This 20 microfarad, you cannot eliminate. Okay, such unbalanced bridges become complicated. Okay, so if this is if this kind of circuits, they are complicated, in such cases you will use Kirchhoff laws and we will solve the problem. Or else I'll tell you one simple method to solve this, but stay tuned. I will be teaching that in current electricity, not now. Students, we have already learnt in the past few lectures, like when you are taking a capacitor and this capacitor plates are being filled with some dielectric medium. This dielectric medium have dielectric constant K. In such cases, you already learnt that the capacity of the capacitor will be increased, right? If suppose its capacity is C, if you are placing the hole, like if you are replacing the hole medium in between two plates with dielectric medium of constant K, in such cases, then its capacity becomes C dash, which is K into C. This we have already learned. Right? Now, what actually happens when you are placing a dielectric medium in between the two capacitor plates of parallel plate capacitor? Let me explain. Now, when you are, see, this is electric field. Electric field is in which direction? Electric field is in downward direction. And this is plate one of parallel plate capacitor. And this is plate two of parallel plate capacitor. You have two plates. And this plate is connected to one potential and this plate is connected to another potential. Let me connect this with positive of the battery and the other one with zero. So as these two plates are connected with battery, therefore there will be electric field set up here and electric field will be from positive to negative terminal of the battery. Therefore this has positive and this is negative. Electric field is in downward direction. When you are placing a dielectric medium, usually it will be a gas. Gases are bad conductors of electricity. So therefore you will be taking some gas molecules within this two plates of the capacitor. Now these molecules, they can align themselves in external electric field depending upon their composition in such a way all positive centers come towards one side, negative centers come towards the other side, right? For example, as I already explained in electrostatics chapter, I have explained what actually dipole mean and how does that dipole constitute. So if you are taking molecule because of these plates, if you are taking molecule over here, all positive centers come over here, negative centers come over here. If this is positive, negative will be attracted. If this is negative, positives will be attracted. All negative charges will be attracted towards this positive plate. Positive charges will be attracted towards negative plate, resulting in some distance between positive and negative centers. Right? This is dipole. This is nothing but dipole. Now, whenever you are taking a molecule and placing it in external electric field, negative and positive centers get separated. Such type of molecules where you are where the negative and positive centers get separated, they are said to be as polar molecules. Right? But whereas in some cases the molecules does not have any effect even though you are placing it in external electric field, the positive and negative centers does not get separated, then they does not have any effect with the electric field. Only those molecules which are present over here within this dielectric medium, such that positive and negative centers get separated, that constitute one dipole. As the dipole is placed in electric field externally, it get aligned in the direction of external field. Right? Now see here, this is external field, and see this dipole, there is one molecule in such a way, positive and negative centers get separated over there, such that it is aligned in the direction of electric field. Okay, but whereas in some cases it may not be that much effective, like some molecules does not get positive and negative centers getting separated. So in such cases there is no effect because dipole is not been formed over there. As a result, there is no effect upon that molecule. So because you are getting one dipole over here, as a result, all those dipoles get aligned in the direction of external electric field because of that. Come to this figure now. You are taking one plate. This is another plate. It is positive. It is negative. And the molecules which are now being formed as dipoles, they get aligned in the direction of electric field in such a way, due to that dipole moment, there will be another electric field induced within this dielectric slab, and that is called as induced field. It is called as induced electric field. External electric field is due to connected battery, right? This is external electric field. And inside there are molecules. Those all molecules are getting aligned in such a way, negative centers get attracted towards the positive plate, positive centers get attracted towards the negative plate. As a result, there will be electric field induced within that dielectric slab, and that is in opposite direction to that of external electric field. Right? Therefore, now you can consider overall electric field E net will be equal to E external, it is because of the battery, minus E induced. E induced. Right? If at all the molecules are placed in between the two plates of capacitors, if in such a way the positive and negative centers get separated, that phenomenon is known as polarization. It is called as polarization. And polarized molecules and non-polarized molecules, because of all those polarized molecules, induced electric field is set up in opposite direction to that of external electric field, resulting in net electric field decreased. So net electric field will be slightly decreased because induced electric field is in opposite direction to that of the external electric field. And this is called as, it is known as polarization. Polarization of dielectric medium placed in external electric field in between the two capacitor plates. So that is what, when you are placing a dielectric medium in between the plates of capacitor, the effect is that they get polarized. Now, if you are taking two plates, as we know, when we are taking two plates, one is positive and the negative. Internally, there will be electric field here, and that electric field E will be equal to sigma divided by epsilon naught, because it is in between these two plates. Now, what you are doing is you are taking a dielectric medium, and that dielectric medium is placed in between these two plates. As a result, what would happen? Positive, towards this positive, negative charges get attracted, and towards this negative, positive charges get attracted. And as a result, from positive to negative, there is another electric field E induced. Now I need to write down equation for induced electric field, and that equation for induced electric field can be written as sigma B divided by epsilon naught, right? Induced, like sigma B is the charge density on this dielectric slab. On this dielectric slab, charge density I am considering it as sigma B, where sigma is charge density on capacitor plates, and sigma B is equal to charge density on dielectric slab. Overall, you can write E net. You can calculate net electric field is equal to E minus E induced, which is equal to sigma divided by epsilon naught minus sigma B divided by epsilon naught, right? So this is how you can find out effective net field, which is the difference of external electric field minus induced electric field. Induced electric field is sigma B divided by epsilon naught. So finally, you can write down E net is equal to, this is E net equation. E net is equal to sigma by epsilon naught into 1 minus 1 by k. And from here, see, E induced is sigma B by epsilon naught, right? Sigma B can be related like this. Sigma B is equal to sigma into 1 minus 1 by k. Okay, so wherever sigma B is there, you can just replace it with sigma into 1 minus 1 by k. That gives you the net electric field. It's very, very simple to understand. Whatever I have explained previously, same thing it is been present in this slide. So whenever your external plates, these are external plates, they have sigma, and this is dielectric medium, they have sigma B, which is charge density, and the effective electric field is E minus E induced, E is a sigma by epsilon naught minus sigma B by epsilon naught. And as you can write E induced is equal to sigma by k epsilon naught, you can write sigma B is equal to sigma into 1 minus 1 by k, where k is equal to dielectric constant. So this is the effect of dielectric medium. So when you are placing dielectric medium in between two plates of the capacitor, its capacity increases by default. In the previous case, we have filled the dielectric medium completely within the two plates. Now let us come to case one, where you are not completely filling the space between two plates with dielectric medium. It is partially filled. See, this is empty. This is empty. Empty in the sense it is air. Here also it is air. Only a part is being filled with dielectric medium. Now in this air medium, what is the electric field? Sigma by epsilon naught. In the air medium, sigma by epsilon naught, electric field remains same as it is, like external electric field. But what about inside? Within the dielectric medium, electric field E induced, it will be sigma divided by k epsilon naught. Right? So the total electric field produced by bound induced charge on the dielectric outside the slab is zero, because they cancel each other. Like what it means is, you have this dielectric medium. Inside the dielectric medium, electric field is sigma by k epsilon naught. But outside this dielectric slab, E induced is equal to 0. So here E induced will be equal to 0. Here E induced will be equal to 0. E induced will be 0 outside the dielectric slab, and outside the dielectric slab only external E external is possible. This is not equal to 0. Here also E external is not equal to 0. But due to this dielectric slab, field inside will be equal to 0. Right? That is one important thing you need to remember. And case number 2. Sometimes there may be dielectric mediums which are being placed like this. See, you have a plate plus sigma minus sigma. That is charge density on the two plates. You are now taking two slabs whose thickness is T1 and thickness is T2. You are arranging them like this. This is air medium. This is air medium. And this is air medium. Okay. Now only in this dielectric slab, as its dielectric constant is K1, you have E induced as a sigma divided by K1 epsilon naught. And in this dielectric slab, as its dielectric constant is K1, here also induced will be equal to sigma by, this is K2, sigma divided by K2 epsilon naught, right? Now you can consider these two plates. Sorry, this is plate and this is plate. These two are the dielectric slabs. You are placing two dielectric slabs in such a way, the separation between the two slabs is being divided into 1, 2, and 3. Three parts. But whereas in the case 1, it is being divided into only two parts. It is 1 and this is 2. Remaining is completely filled with dielectric medium. Sometimes even you may have like this. Say you can take a dielectric slab. This is one dielectric slab and this is another dielectric slab and this is other dielectric slab. Three dielectric slabs you can take whose dielectric constant is K1, K2 and K3. This is air medium and this is air medium. So effective capacitance varies depending upon the dielectric constant. If it is completely filled with only one medium, effective capacitance is K into C. But what about here? What about here? What about here? How to find out the effective capacity? That we will be learning in the next video session. Finding the effective capacitance with dielectric medium will be discussed in other video sessions.